those of you I don't know, my name is Joan Gable. I'm the Dean of the Robert J. Trulaske Senior College of Business, and it's my pleasure to welcome you today to our Dean's Distinguished Lecture Series. Before we begin, I'd like to ask that you turn your cell phones off, not just vibrate off. I'm looking for you reaching into your pockets to do that. Thank you. And then put them away. Please stay until the completion of the program. That's going to include a Q&A segment, and we'd really like you to stay all the way through that portion. During that segment, I really encourage you to ask your follow-up questions as time permits, and we were just speaking about that our esteemed speaker would really be delighted to hear from you. So one of the strategic priorities of the Trulaske College of Business is to make sure there is collaboration between industry experts and our students. We really think this is a key piece that we provide you to equip you for success when you graduate. And these business partners and friends play a really important role in your preparation and readiness for real-world challenges that you'll be facing sooner rather than later. In general, we ask our speakers and try to identify speakers who have knowledge about trends, issues, practices, challenges, how to turn those challenges into opportunity, advice, words of wisdom, war stories, and sometimes just examples that we can all follow, myself included, as we move forward through our respective careers, because we know each person, each path, each success story has its own unique baskets of insights and unique perspectives. And our speaker today is a prime example of that. It's my pleasure to introduce you to Mr. Greg Stubblefield. Mr. Stubblefield is the Executive Vice President and Chief Strategy Officer of Enterprise Holdings, ranked number 17 on the Forbes 500 Private Companies in America list. Enterprise Holdings is now the largest car rental company in the world and operates in more than twice as many neighborhood and airport locations as its nearest U.S. competitor. Mr. Stubblefield began his career with Enterprise Rent-A-Car as a management trainee. Doesn't that sound familiar for many of you nearing graduation, and a path we would all like to be able to say we followed upon graduation? And from there, ascended into various leadership positions throughout the company. In 2007, following the acquisition of Alamo Rent-A-Car and National Car Rental Brands, he was appointed as president of Alamo and National, overseeing the largest acquisition ever in the rental car industry. He was named to his current position in 2009 at Enterprise Holdings St. Louis headquarters. In addition to his work with Enterprise, Mr. Stubblefield currently serves on the U.S. Travel and Tourism Advisory Board, which provides counsel to the Secretary of Commerce on issues of current tourism, industry concerns, and emerging issues in government policies. So please join me in welcoming Mr. Greg Stubblefield.
Thanks, Dean. Thanks, I appreciate it.
Dean Grable, thank you very, very much. It's really a pleasure and honor to be here today with all of you. And driving down here today, Mizzou is just a great place. Columbia is terrific. And I just want to say thank you for asking us to come down and speak. We're very, very honored. Before I get started, I want to also say thank you to Tim Hausman for showing us around today and spending some time with us, and Jordan Duke as well. We had great lunch with some of the students, and then Joe Stevens, some of your MBA folks. Thank you very much. Really, really appreciate it. at Enterprise Holdings, we have a great relationship with the University of Missouri. We have hundreds of graduates that we have employed in very, very senior positions. And in fact, our president and chief operating officer, Pam Nicholson, is a University of Missouri graduate from here in Columbia. You may recognize her from some of the commercials, the ones with John Hamm that talk about the University of Missouri. She's the one yelling Z-O-U in front of the car as you're watching the football game. But she's a great ambassador for the University of Missouri, Daryl Scales. We were just talking about that. He heads up our accounting and finance over in our European division. He's a University of Missouri graduate along with his son. So we've got a great relationship. So thank you very, very much. We're really going to cover a couple things today. One, I'm going to talk to you about a little bit about Enterprise Holdings, just give you some quick context to it. Two, I'm going to give you a couple of bullet points from some case studies on some acquisitions. Not go in depth about the total acquisition, but a few little bullet points on the acquisitions of some that you'd recognize. And then thirdly, I'm going to go into the acquisition that we did in the rental car industry and hit on a handful of things that we thought were very important. By no means are any of those exhaustive lists, because we don't have the time, but they are just a few things that we thought we'd highlight on acquisition do's and don'ts, if you will. And then in addition to that, we want to finish with a question and answer session for all of you, and any questions you have, I'd be more than happy to answer. So let me quickly start with who Enterprise Holdings is. We're the world's largest rental car company, as Dean Grable said, both in terms of revenue, fleet, employees, locations, however you would want to measure that. We're the largest rental car company in the world. We're the operator of three rental car brands. We have our Alamo, our Enterprise rental car brand, our National Car Rental brand. And from a locations point of view as well, we have twice as many as our next competitor, but quite frankly, we have more than the rest of the U.S. market put together in terms of number of locations. We were founded in 1957 by Jack Taylor, and he had a really simple philosophy. Take care of your customers and your employees first, and profits will follow. We still follow that mantra today. Everybody in the management of the company really understands that. We try to disseminate that through the organization. From 1960 to 1980 is really where we started to expand, and that's a 20-year time span, and we grew from those seven cars to really 69 branches. Andy Taylor was named president, CEO. We had 5,000 rental cars over those 20 years, and we did about $23 million in revenue under the rental car. We had a leasing company as well, but our rental division over those 20 years, we grew to that. If you look at this slide, over the following decade, we had some pretty expansive growth. We started at 5,000 rental cars, and I started my career with the company in 1982, and we had about 6,000 cars. By the end of the decade, we had 500 locations and 50,000 vehicles. And we changed our name from Enterprise Leasing Company to Enterprise Rent-A-Car because that became our flagship business. We really built that in what we call the home city market or the off-airport. We built it with the insurance companies, body shops, dealerships, being a virtual car, if you will, for people. And the replacement business, as we call it, is still one of our major businesses, if not our major business today, and that's really all in the off-airport market. In the mid-1990s, we decided we'd expand to the airports, and that was really driven because our friends and family in the home city said, we'd like to use you when we travel. And so we created a series of what we call off-airport locations that were anywhere from a quarter of a mile to a mile away from the airport, that we pick you up at the terminal and bring you over. And it was really designed for family and friends, never with the real intention of becoming a true full airport business at that point. To give you the context, you know, mid-1990s, we started the airports. And by 2007, the rental car market in the United States had grown to a $22 billion market, of which half of that was done off airport. And the majority of that was driven by our branch locations and bringing neighborhood locations. So we really grew that market. And by 2007, it was a 50-50 in terms of the share of market. We had a tremendous share and tremendous position in the off-airport market. But as you can see from here, in the on-airport from 1995-96 to 2007, in the airport, that $11 billion market, we had grown to 7.6%. The thing that's interesting here is if you look at it, in 2007, the airport market was pretty consolidated. You really had four companies that had 90% of the business. And in addition to that, you were starting to see rental car companies over the previous decade start to consolidate. Dollar and Thrifty consolidated, Alamo and National consolidated, Avis and Budget consolidated into one company. And so they really controlled 90% of the market. And to put this into context, prior to our acquisition, Dollar, Thrifty, and National Alamo had been discussing a merger and acquisition for upwards of 11 months prior to us getting involved. And so that kind of gives you the context of 2007. Today, we have three brands. We have our Enterprise brand, our Alamo brand, and our National brand. And they each serve separate markets. And I'll share with that later with how they're segmented out. Our branch total is about 7,700 branches worldwide. We just surpassed 1 million cars that we own. That puts us as the largest owner of passenger vehicles in the world and the largest rental car company in the world. In addition to that, our original business that we started, the leasing company, today has 207,000 cars, a little over 200,000. And it's a fantastic business for us, and we feel great about where that's going. We also have a retail used car operation. We have 150 retail used car lots where we sell our rental cars to consumers after we're done with them. And we sell about 65,000 cars a year through that 150,000 network. So that makes us probably the second or the third largest retailer of used cars in the United States. We're the largest seller of cars in the United States because we wholesale another 800 to 850,000 a year, but we retail about 65,000. We also have a truck rental division, a commercial truck rental division. Box trucks is up to 26 foot. We have a ride share and a van pool, which is more mobility transit business for governments and large corporations to and from work to home. And we also have an incubator company we call car sharing. It's called WeCar, and we have that on the campus here at the University of Missouri. And that's really what you've known as the car sharing. It's a membership-based organization where you set up your profile, and then you can do an automated car share or car rental an hour at a time or a day at a time, however that would be. And we just finished our fiscal year in July, is the end of our fiscal year, and we just surpassed $14 billion in revenue, which would put us about somewhere between 15th and 16th as the largest privately held company in America, still owned by the Taylor family who originally started it. So that kind of gives you a context of who Enterprise Holdings is. Let me go into for a couple minutes the concept of mergers and acquisitions. If you really study it, there's about $2 trillion every year spent on mergers and acquisitions, as reported by the Harvard Business Review. And the shocking statistic that you read is 70 to 90% of all those acquisitions and or mergers fail. We think about it, we hear all the hoopla about how good the acquisition was and what it did for share price and all these other things. But if you really study them after the fact, 70 to 90%, and some would argue 80 to 85% of all of them, but 70 to 90% fail. And they fail for a number of reasons. I'm going to focus on a couple, but they fail for a number of reasons and they succeed for a number of reasons. But if your failure rate is far exceeds your success rate, there's something that really needs to be studied there. And so we're going to talk about that a little bit. Let me first share a couple of examples and many case studies with you. If you look at Sprint and Nextel, remember that? Nextel was a real high flyer in 2005. Everybody had a Nextel phone. And we had them for all our remarketing folks and everything else. Sprint bought Nextel in 2005, and they bought them for a $35 billion acquisition price, a big, big acquisition in 2005. That deal created the third largest telecom company in the industry. Okay? Great merger, great idea. We're going to be number three. Here we go. $35 billion, lots of money. But what happened was the two cultures clashed. Okay? And what happened was the folks in one of the companies, Nextel, started to depart. The cultures clashed. The service started to erode. So their base of customers that each had started to erode. Okay, because the service just wasn't there. In addition to that, all of a sudden there was an onset of competition that came into the market. AT&T, Verizon, the iPhone, so on and so forth. So all of a sudden, Sprint Nextel was distracted through the acquisition by cultural issues and then competitive issues. The net result of that acquisition, in 2008, they had to take a $30 billion write-down. And today, the combined entities do $33 billion in revenue, but they have $10 billion in market cap versus a combined $77 billion in market cap when they did the acquisition. In that scenario, you hear me talk about acquisitions are designed to be, or mergers, 1 + 1 equals something greater than 2. That's the whole idea behind it. And that could be from a growth point of view. It could be from a financial point of view. There's a host of them, but all mergers and acquisitions start out with the concept of 1 + 1 is going to be greater than 2, or you wouldn't really go into that process, okay? And so as you look at this, you look at it and go, wow, $77 billion of market cap down to 10, that's something far less. And if you think about it in the telecom world today, Sprint Nextel compared to AT&T and Verizon and Apple in those cases that are out there, they're just a far back in the pack. So that's an example of one, and that was really two pieces, cultural and competitive nature. There was a lot of other things, but I'm just giving you some highlights. Here's another one, and you're reading about a lot lately. If you pick up the newspaper or if you go online, watch the news, B of A. In 2008, Bank of America acquired Countrywide for $4.1 billion. If you remember, that was just prior to the economic crisis and some things like that, and Countrywide had built the largest mortgage originator there was in the country. They had grown and done a terrific job. Their market cap at the time, Bank of America, was $196 billion, and Countrywide had a market cap of about $3.3 billion. Okay? So you look at a combined market cap of $2 billion. In addition to that, but it was a very different business. Countrywide was a very centralized mortgage originator. Bank of America had gone through a process where Ken Lewis had bought up regional banks to become a regional bank for consumers primarily. And they started to shift to become a loan originator. And then in September of 2008, they bought Merrill Lynch for $50 billion. And Merrill Lynch was more of an investment banking and a portfolio management company for mid to high net worth individuals, as opposed to a retail bank. And if you look at that, market cap for B of A from January to September had lost about $100 billion, but they picked up Merrill, who had $24 billion in market cap. Okay, so if you back up to January, that market cap combined for the three would have been about $125 billion. But in January, that sat at about, $225 billion. In January, it sat at about $125 billion. Fast forward to December, Merrill posted a $15 billion loss. Senior Merrill bankers started to join the competitors and leave because the culture at Bank of America was vastly different than the culture at Merrill Lynch. Combined with some of the due diligence process that they went through during that period, led to a $15 billion loss and a lot of distraction and conflict between the entities. Okay? And as the investment portfolio managers from Merrill started to leave, their portfolios went with them. So they had a real culture and a morale issue at the time. July loss, Bank of America reported $8.8 billion in a quarterly loss, and they are underwater with the Countrywide acquisition they had, with the amount of loans and the due diligence and the process and regulation that Countrywide went through to validate and verify the information on loans, if you read about it. And so they're still buried under this mass of bad loans that they acquired. So their core business is very, very distracted, which was Bank of America, a regional residential consumer bank. Their investment bank is under fire because their top talent left. Their mortgage origination company is under fire because of its administrative and business practices. And then next thing they do is you start to look at it in September 11th, Bank of America announced an additional 30,000 layoffs. Okay? In addition to that, you know, Brian Moynihan, who runs it, you can read about all this in the paper, he took his top people, because Ken Lewis left, Brian Moynihan took his top people that oversaw each of these sectors, and he's replacing them all now. So you have, 3 years ago, a bank that is really in great financial shape under its core business, makes acquisitions outside of its core, is distracted by practices and morale and culture, combined with the economic issues that hit, and lo and behold, their market cap is $65 billion as the three combined. And here we are in September, and it's down 50% since January. And they're laying a lot of people off. Again, 1 plus 1 plus 1 equaled something less than 1 to begin with. Federated, another one. 2005, Federated bought May Company for $11 billion. Federated had revenues of about $15.5 billion in May Company. St. Louis-based company had revenues of about $14.4 billion. One of the things Federated decided to do, and this has to do with brand names, okay? Federated decided, which has the Macy's name, decided they would eliminate the regional names and the prominent names that May Company had carried, Robinson's May, Marshall Field's, Famous Bar, and a host of other ones. And they would label everything under one brand, Macy's, okay? And so they had about $30 billion in revenue at the time. And they also made some strategic changes in the way they wanted to market, because if you've got a multitude of companies and brands, and then you can consolidate in one, the independent brand managers don't have as much value as they used to, because now you're going with a single brand, and you're going after all segments with a single brand, which is different than niche segments. Very, very different marketing and how you go after it. But that's okay, they made that decision that that's what they wanted to do. From an efficiency standpoint, brand, marketing, expense, a whole host of reasons. And they also changed their supply management, okay? As you get into the big box stores and the bigger they get, supply chain management is one of their key things. If you look at Walmart, their vendor supplies and all that, that's a competitive advantage, okay? And Federated through Macy's thought they could add that as a competitive advantage to their overall process as well by streamlining that. Today, Macy's revenue as a combined entity, if you remember, it was $30 billion upon acquisition. Today, it sits at $26 billion, less than the combined companies at that time. Their market cap today is $11 billion versus $20 billion when they made the acquisition. If you remember, the market cap just for May Company back at the acquisition was $11 billion. Okay? So when for May Company, when Federated bought them, And today, their combined entities are $11 billion. Again, one plus one based upon what they did, both some cultural issues, supply chain, and brand management, turned out to be something less than one plus one equals two. And that becomes real important because each of these have a different reason why they did. This could be brand management, supply chain, cultural, leadership. There's a whole host of different things. But as you can see, some big, big acquisitions and mergers over the last 5 years have failed. Let me give you an example of a great one. Okay, Disney and Pixar. In 2006, Disney acquired Pixar for $7.4 billion. And at the time, the analysts questioned the price. They thought that was way, way, way out of line. But in Disney's ability to integrate, because Disney under Michael Eisner was a very, very, very successful company, but they were pretty rigid in terms of their standards and their integration outside the Disney culture. Very, very tough. Eisner was a tremendous leader, did a great job for Disney, but one of the challenges was it was a very closed culture in that sense. So the analysts wondered, could they integrate? Because Pixar, if you remember, was Steve Jobs who came out and created this very unique, creative, digitized company, right? Very different than historical Disney, who had the theme parks, who had the entertainment division, all those things. Very, very different. How could they bring that into the culture? So people said, wow, we don't know about that. But that was an ideal situation because it blended Disney's tremendous marketing and distribution network, really second to none in that industry in terms of how they can distribute brand merchandise, DVDs, movies, market things. They're fantastic at that. So they took Pixar and brought in the creative. The first movie they did was Cars. It sold $460 million in tickets, 27 million DVDs, and $5 billion in merchandise. For Disney, they could put that through their system, no problem. Producing 27 million DVDs, $5 billion in merchandise, $460 million in tickets through all the movie theaters. For Disney, that was just a day's work. For Pixar, it would have been impossible for them to get that out there. For them to try to figure out how to get $5 billion in merchandising in some fashion to beat everybody in the market would have been impossible. The combined entity did great on that. And here's a couple of quotes on that. One is from David Price, who's the author of The Pixar Touch, The Making of a Company. Most acquisitions are value-destroying, not value-creating. That has not been the case here. Disney preserved the culture of Pixar as a creative entity. Pixar didn't try to become what Disney was, which is a tremendous marketing, distribution, entertainment company. Disney CEO, now Robert Iger, you can accomplish a lot more as one company when everyone is working for the same set of shareholders. Okay, and the reason for that is he was under a little bit of a heat. They were in a little bit of heat for acquiring the whole company as opposed to doing a joint venture. Okay, but in a joint venture, sometimes you have opposing views of what one company or one shareholder wants. Putting it all under the umbrella worked, in this case, extremely well. So in terms of those case studies, just a couple of key pieces from a takeaway. One, common vision is really, really important. If you don't have common vision, culture and morale goes. Great leadership is really important. You're bringing two separate entities or three together. Someone needs to be a great leader and then have other great leaders. Clear financial objectives. If you don't have those, it's pretty hard for everybody to follow those. Clear operational goals as well. If you don't have those, a lot of different cultures going a lot of different directions. And then cultural compatibility. Okay, you really got to look at that and understand, how do I get that? It's similar to a football team or a basketball team when they go into camp in the summer. They go into camp because they have to build a team. They got 4 weeks to go into camp, practice, get really good, but come out as a team because you have new people. You got people that are returning. You got people that are in better shape than they were, worse shape than they were, so on and so forth. But you got to build a team. And so you go in there, and you got to build that single team as they come out. Some do it successfully, some don't. Let me go for a few minutes to our acquisition. We made an acquisition in 2007, as Dean Grable said, of Alamo National. Their parent company was Vanguard. It was about a little over a $3 billion acquisition, largest one in the rental car industry. And the reason we did it is the acquisition offered us an opportunity to improve our competitive position in the North American market. And we had 7.6% of the market in 2007, as I showed you earlier. And there was just a handful of companies, three of them besides us, or four, that had at the time 90% of the market. And we were highly concerned that if two of them got together, now you'd have a very consolidated industry with three owners that had 90% of the market share. And how would one grow and develop through that? Because opening and growing in the airport business is extremely complex compared to the off because of property and restrictions. And so that was highly concerning. So we had an opportunity over a 3 to 4 week period to make a decision of whether or not we wanted to acquire them or not. And we made the decision through our ownership to acquire that company. Then we set about the business to figure out what we wanted to do with it and how we wanted to operate it. But what made us and what allowed us to make that decision fairly quickly is we assessed our own strengths and our own weaknesses. And because when you take on something, if you don't have your strengths assessed really well, that can really hurt you as you do an acquisition, because you're going to be challenged in ways you've never been challenged before. And if that challenges you to take all your good talent and go over here, your core business starts to suffer, similar to what the Bank of America story was. That starts to suffer. Now you're suffering on two sides, and you're really stretched. One of the things that we realized early on is that we have a strong management team that we had built up over the years, and our strength and our depth of management was second to none in the industry and still is. But that was built up over a long period of time from organically growing everybody through the system. So we knew that we could take this on without impacting our core business. Okay? And that was really important. The other thing we wanted to make sure of was the financial side of it. For a privately held company to take on a $3 billion acquisition, similar to Disney One, the analysts felt like we're a privately held company with the organically grown culture. How are you going to integrate it? You've never taken on something of that size. What are you going to do? We're not so sure that that's going to work. But we shared with them from a financial point of view, that wasn't a big risk for us. Okay? We recognized that taking this on because of the balance sheet that we had had and we had built up over the years, this wasn't a financial acquisition to improve our financial bottom line. This was to grow our market share and give us a position in the airport. But we also knew it wouldn't impact our financial balance sheet. That was really important. So we shared with everybody up front, this challenge was not financial, it was cultural and operational. Could we, a confederation at enterprise of small local branches, take on these big box stores at the airport that had, you know, more of a system and a process as opposed to these small 4 to 10 car offices that we had, 10 people offices that we had everywhere, to these big box stores like in Orlando, where we've got 500 employees in a shift? We hadn't built that expertise. We had built the other expertise. So could we operationally understand how to integrate that in? And from a cultural point of view, everybody in the enterprise world had been a recent college graduates, started in the management training system and worked their way through. And if you had had industry experience, that wasn't viewed as a positive, it was viewed as a negative. And that was the culture that had been built over time very successfully. Now you're going to take on a culture of thousands of employees that grew up in a competitive environment, in a different system, and a whole host of them having never gone to college because they were hired in for specific positions that didn't require that. And I'll talk about that in a minute. So we realized it was cultural and operational. We talked about that. So let me share with you for a minute what we did in terms of recognize that. I'm going to go through about 4 or 5 points here. But first and foremost, consistency of leadership. These are the things we looked at and said, we have to assess this, recognize it, and then do our due diligence on how to improve this. So the first thing we said was leadership and consistency of it. The enterprise world, we'd had 2 CEOs over 55 years. Jack Taylor, the founder, and his son, Andy Taylor, who's still our chairman and CEO. So that's pretty consistent leadership. We had one owner over 55 years. You can't get much more consistent than that. The same values and principles and everything come. Vanguard or Alamo National, on the other hand, had long since left their founders, and they had been bought and sold about 7 to 10 times over the previous 12 years. They had gone into bankruptcy, emerged from a private equity firm with the intent that they were only going to dress it up so they could sell it. They had 7 different CEOs before I went in, and so in the prior 10 years. And so the consistency changed every 12 to 18 months. So the culture and the leadership was really, what's important? What are we going to do now? Very, very different from a leadership point of view. Very different. So we needed to articulate our values, okay? Because there was only going to be one leader, And there was, and that was going to be consistent because we weren't buying it to buy it and pretty it up and sell it. We were buying it to operate it. So what was important was not what we knew inherently from having lived it. I've been there almost 30 years. But we had to articulate and disseminate that to people that, one, weren't very trusting because they had been bought and sold 10 times. And they had 7 CEOs that shared a lot of things. And so there was skepticism as to whether or not we'd really buy them and hold them, or we'd buy them and turn around and sell them. And so we had to articulate and disseminate our values, both culturally and operationally. So we went about that business, and I'm not going to go into these in depth, but we have 2 sets of core values in the enterprise holdings world, and it's been that way forever. One is our founding values and our cultural compass, and it hits all the things that we think are extremely important on the left side that are not operational in nature, but they're our founding values, and they guide us down the path. Okay, and we follow those through our organization. So we had to disseminate that and teach to everybody what that meant. And it goes from operations down through environmental conservation, philanthropy, all those different things. The other side was the operating side. Okay, a lot of operators make things very complex. We make it very, very simple. Because we believe if you can articulate and disseminate, even if I didn't grow up in that world, and it's very simple, I can learn that pretty quick. Okay. And so we have 4 core areas, and everybody in the company knew it. And part of my job was to help teach the folks at Alamo National what this meant. Okay? And customer satisfaction was 1. Employee retention was 2. Growth of the business was 3, and profitability was 4. That was hard, because if you're owned by a private equity firm, I don't think those are the order of priorities. I think it kind of reverses a little bit with profitability up top, so I can then get an exit strategy. And nothing against private equity, I think they're fantastic. Their mission is just different than ours. We're an operating company in a long-term hold. And so if you're from a private equity world and profit, 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 and yield, 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 and you know, let's do this, 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 so we can turn around and sell it, and the operation's doing that, then you come in and say, well, we're gonna change that. Here's your operational goals. That's very hard. So we had to articulate and disseminate that to them and then make them believe it. So we started with the articulation, dissemination, and the leadership. And everybody in senior leadership, including ownership in the enterprise holding world, visited, talked. I spent a whole host of time traveling around all the operations that Alamo National had in not only the United States, but outside the United States, talking and sharing and doing town halls about these things. Next, we went to customer satisfaction. And there's really... And I'll do this briefly, but the customer satisfaction you saw was the 1 operating goal of enterprise, and it's also one of our founding values. We want to exceed our customers' expectations, and that comes from our founder. He wants to make everybody feel good about doing business with us, and that's the most important thing. And so over a 20-year period, we've made that part of our fabric. And so at enterprise, we have a SQI system, Service Quality Index system, that is part of the fabric, and if you're not equal to or above the corporate average in that, you are not eligible for promotion no matter what. You could be the best financial operator that we have. You're not eligible for promotion unless you can exceed customer satisfaction, period. And we only measure the top box. A lot of companies and a lot of industries measure whether you're satisfied or not. We only measure the top box. You're either completely satisfied or you get no credit. But that didn't happen overnight. It took us 20 years. 15 years to really develop that and do some great things with it. National Alamo, when I went in and visited everybody, they had something called QSP, Quality Service Quality Service Producer. And it's a great measurement. It had 264 different things they measure. The SQI measures 2. Okay? Talk about 2 different worlds in 14 different categories. So I went around and traveled and visited and listened to what the QSP was all about, and I said, wow, that's a great measurement. That's fantastic. It has nothing to do with customer satisfaction, but they use that as their customer satisfaction tool. I said, but it's a great tool. It is absolutely fantastic. We're not getting rid of it, but it doesn't have anything to do with customers. So we're going to take QSP and put that on the enterprise brand as well, because it doesn't have anything like that, and it's a great efficiency measurement tool to improve your process and efficiency. It's fantastic. And today, under all 3 brands, we have QSP. But we also took SQI and put it under National Alamo. And today, so, and but we didn't just put it under there. What we did was we went out did a pilot program, got their measurements. But then we said to them, because remember, you're bringing and introducing something into a culture that has never been expected to do that. So we said, here's what the measurement is. Here's why we do it. Here's your results, because we did some pilot programs and tests. Now what we're going to do is teach, train, and develop you over the next 6 months. At the end of 6 months, we're going to hold you accountable. Prior to that, we're going to come out, teach, train, develop. We're going to do everything under the sun. But month 7, you own this number. If you don't believe in it, that's okay. You don't have to be here. But in month 7, this is your number one priority. So we'll teach, train, and develop. But make no mistake, this is the number one priority. And so we went through that process, and some adapted to it, some didn't, in terms of some things like that. But it didn't happen overnight. Like I shared, the enterprise, it took us 15 or 20 years. Okay, the results we've achieved in 4 years with National Alamo because of the history is unbelievable. And today, with our J.D. Powers, which you all should be familiar with J.D. Powers, our enterprise brand has hit 7 years in a row as the number one rental car company in 11 out of the last 12 years. Last year, 2009, 2010, we took the first, second, and fourth spots. Our national brand was number 2, up from number 6. Our Alamo brand was number 4, up from number 7, from when we acquired it. And today, believe it or not, the national brand, in turn, we measure it every day, every month, our national brand actually exceeds our enterprise brand in our service quality index. So from a culture point of view, it was not only introduced, but it was embraced. And today, J.D. Powers comes out in a month, and we're hoping that we take all three spots. But more importantly, as we do brand segmentation, enterprise is number one in customer satisfaction across the total rental space. National, which focuses on the corporate business traveler, is number one in the corporate business traveler. Alamo, which focuses on the leisure business under J.D. Powers, is number one in the leisure business. So in their segments, we own number one across the board. We own 1, 2, and 4 in terms of the total category. So from a cultural point of view, we feel great about where that's gone. Let me talk to you for a second about employee development and retention, which is the next one. Enterprise, I shared with you, we had from promote from within management trainee. At National Alamo, for example, management trainees would sign on. They'd go through a 4 to 6 week training program and then move into management. Okay, and it was more classroom training and visiting a site. It wasn't on-the-job training. Two vastly different worlds in terms of how you develop managers. The enterprise system, you on-the-job training, and over 12, 18, 24 months, you start to matriculate into management. Under National Alamo, 4 to 6 weeks in a classroom and a training program, you're now our manager, whether you have industry experience or not. Two vastly different worlds. So we had to abandon, and we talked to everybody that was in management, and they were grandfathered in, and that was fine. But we only needed one management training program. We didn't need two. So we abandoned the National Alamo one. And if anybody in the system wanted to get into management, and they weren't in management as of yet, but they wanted to, they went through the enterprise system. So it was clear to them that everybody had an opportunity. Anybody could do it, college degree or not. They were on the team. They could go through the management system and matriculate to management. But there was only one place everybody was going, and everybody had an opportunity. And we didn't hold to whether you have a college degree or not, because we had inherited those through the acquisition, and they had every opportunity to matriculate through the company as anybody. And anybody who was in management was already in. So we didn't have to do that. And today we only have one management system, one management training program, and it's worked out fantastic. And the pool of managers that we have all come from that. Whichever brand they go to, they come from that management pool. Net result, key leadership positions we filled from both sides. January 2009, we started what we called tri-branding, because we had National Alamo here, Enterprise here, and the teams were at the airport, but they weren't managed collectively. So starting in January of 2009, we put them together under one team of management. So we called it a tri-branded manager. So now instead of having two managers, one that oversaw this and one that oversaw that, we picked the best of the two and put them in charge, or her in charge. We had a tri-branded manager. We didn't get rid of the other one. We moved them into another management position. But we only had one voice over all three brands. And the management team, we did that in January 2009 before we fully integrated it. And we didn't charge them from a profit and loss point of view in January 2009. We didn't do that till August, the start of our fiscal year, because we wanted them to test drive the people in the integration before they were responsible and accountable. Because if you make the responsibility and accountability at the same time, sometimes people, even great people, speed to decisions where if you give it a little bit more time, they may make a different decision. So we didn't make it a financial consequence, only a test drive. Here's the people, get to know them. Don't worry about the P&L of it. We'll manage that from over here. You're not going to be impacted by it because each of our stores have their own P&L. But come August, similar to the SQI, come August, you own it. So now's your time to get to know all the people and understand who you got and do all the different things. And come August, you own the financial results going forward. And so that proved to be very good. They shared best practices, best people. We took the National Alamo Operating Reservation System and put it in the airports. Today, our retention across all three brands is an all-time high. Never been higher. So from employee morale, customer satisfaction, all those things went great. But we took our time and really focused in on it. Next, I want to talk to you for a second about brand identity. Enterprise was a brand that tried to be all things to all people, and we have a wonderful brand up through 2007. We still do today. But it really, all we had was one, so you focus on one, and you try to hit all market segments. Today, we have three brands. National Alamo tried to do the same thing and be all things to all people because they had those brands, and they wanted to get the Road Warriors, and they wanted to get the Value Leisure, and they wanted to get the Weekend, and they wanted to do all this. Same with Enterprise. Well, we couldn't have three brands competing because then what we do is we just share shift between our own brands. We didn't want to do that. So to that end, we identify what the brands were. Enterprise is our neighborhood business model, off airport and on, exceptional personal service, and we'll pick you up. Our national brand is our professional business traveler, fast pay, save time and money, avoid the counter, choose your own car, very narrowly focused on about 18% of the travelers, which are the corporate business travelers. And our Alamo brand is on family vacations, inbound international business. About 12% of the business at U.S. and Canadian airports is from foreigners coming here, international business. And so it's about $1.3 billion, and we do about 44% of that market under our Alamo brand. And we focused on value under that. So we really had what we call three swim lanes. Next, growth. Remember the four core areas, growth. Enterprise was a high-growth company. Grow, grow, grow. Grow, grow, grow. And National Alamo is more of a flat fleet, manage to the fleet, manage your yield. That's the best return. Okay? If I have a number of cars, I can fill the bucket with the highest yield, I get the best return. Okay? Enterprise was a high-growth business. So we had to change that up. Today, as a combined entity, and I'll show you in a second, but our double-digit growth in the rental fleet this past year, if you think about it, we've got collectively a little over 50% of the market. And if you look at that, we're growing at double digits in this past year. Tough economic times. The industry as a collective whole is probably a couple of points up, but we, as the largest in the industry, are going at double digits. And this past year alone, we added about 100,000 cars organically to our fleet here in the U.S. and Canada. To put that into perspective, that's the size of Dollar and Thrifty that we've grown over the last year. So we feel great about the combined swim lanes of what they're doing. From an airport market share, that really shows it the best. In the acquisition, the combined was 27.9. Today, we're 33.4% market share. So we're the largest in the industry with our three brands at the airports. 4 years ago, we were 7.6. But the best story here is that from a growth perspective, we picked up 5 or 6 points of market share over that period from what the combined was. Lastly, profitability. Enterprise was very consistent, little volatility in profits. Month in, month out, year in, year out, continue to grow. Very, very stable, very, very consistent. National Alamo is more of a retail model. In a retail world, as you get familiar with it, there's X number of months that they do really well, and the rest of the months, retail businesses kind of hold on, and especially seasonal. And the model was maybe 4 months, 5 months profit. The other months, try to maintain the flat or the loss as low as you can, and so you balance out the year. Well, Enterprise, very, very consistent, low volatility. And I can't share with you what the profitability has been. And the reason for that is we're a privately held company, and those numbers are not out for publication. But I can share with you that in 2007, with the good economic times, that was probably the high water mark for most companies in terms of their success. 2008, everybody took a little bit of hit. And we just finished our 11 year. 2009 was better than 8. Our 2010 year, far exceeded our 2007 year in terms of profitability. It was a record year for us of our 55 years. And in this past year that we just finished in July, from a profitability point of view, we were well into the double digits over our record-breaking year of 2010. And I can't share the numbers with you, but suffice to say, if you look at all the different areas of the acquisition, we feel great about 1 + 1 equaled something far greater than 3 in terms of that in all the core areas. Lastly, a couple of others. We're doing a lot of other acquisitions on franchises. We've done about 30, 35 of them over the last couple of years, and they come in different sizes, shapes, and forms, so we've done a lot there. We've also just acquired a local car sharing company in Philadelphia. Even though it's a small business, the same principles exist. They have a culture, they have a morale, they have you know, missions and leadership, and so we're in the process of doing that in Philadelphia right now. We acquired that about 30, 40 days ago, and it's in the same competitive set as a Zipcar, for example. Do's and don'ts, and then we'll go to questions and answer. Don't bypass assessment of your strengths and weaknesses. Don't maintain hidden agendas. Don't send mixed messages, single leadership, single voice, single message. Don't keep teams separate. Bring them together. You can't have separate teams. It's impossible. Don't operate remotely. When you do an acquisition or a merger, that's when senior leadership and senior management needs to be on the field in the operations and not remotely calling it. You need to be there on hand. Avoid dealing with detractors. Don't do that. If you have detractors, deal with them. A lot of people don't. Oh, that's never going to work. You have to go in and squelch that and deal with detractors right away. Don't complicate priorities. Keep them simple. Remember, you're trying to teach two sides, two new things, because the old isn't necessarily the same, and the new is different. And so you got to keep it simple. And don't settle for less than 1 + 1. You have to set a goal for your team when you take it on. If you don't, they don't really know where they're going to. Some of the do's: do have a clear understanding of your objectives and communicate it constantly. Articulate single vision for combined companies. Implement the transition incrementally. Make sure your headquarters is one voice before you go out to the field, because if not, you got different people going from headquarters that have different missions, different voices, different messages. Share best practices and best people. There's great people on both sides. Share them. Get them back and forth. Do differentiate both new and existing brands, okay? Brand differentiation is really important. We had to, if you think about it, the enterprise brand was an extremely strong market-leading brand. And if you'd grown up in it, that's all you had. And the other brands we took on, we had to teach everybody to be brand agnostic. Because you can't favor one brand over the other, because you'll favor the people, you favor the results. So we had to get everybody to be brand agnostic and customer centric. And by that I meant we've got them into the brand that best served their needs. And so over time we had to disseminate that and get that. Celebrate achievements together based upon new objectives. That's really important. Celebrate those. Make behavior standards transparent to everybody on both sides. And lastly, be open and accessible. Because you're trying to teach a whole new set of people, a whole new set of rules. So those become important. Those are some of the do's and don'ts that we see, and a little bit about the one we had. What I'd like to do at that point is, Dean Grable, is open it up for questions that anybody has. I think we still have plenty of time for some questions. Oh, thanks, Patrick.
Hi, thanks for that. My first question would be, when you acquired National Alamo, how many people did you have to fire, if you did have to fire any?
Well, that's a great question. Initially, we did not let anybody go. And the reason was, there was a business over here that was running that was $3 billion in size, and then the enterprise brand over here was running, and the two didn't really overlap. There was less than a 2% overlap in business, okay? In terms of that, and so we didn't. But what we did do during the process is, as I went around and spent some time, we selectively removed some people that weren't gonna make the transition. And we went in and selectively, as we got to know them, that were detractors, and we removed those folks. And because as we tried to bring it together, we knew they weren't gonna be part of the new mission. And so before we fully integrated it, went around and some of them, and they were some great people, and we treated them all absolutely fantastically, but they knew they weren't going to be, you know, part of the future in terms of coming together. They just didn't like the idea or whatever the reason was. And so we went in and did that selectively. But from a layoff point of view, when we did the acquisition, none. We did do some layoffs during the economic downturn because the industry went down about 20%. We went down a few percentage points. So we had the first layoff in our history. It was relatively small, but it nonetheless, it was a very, very difficult time for us. But that had to do with the economic recession. Today, we're far bigger than we were then. But during the acquisition, we didn't lay anybody off. Yes. Oh, here we go.
You just now spoke about laying off detractors and things. As you were merging the two companies, did you encounter any other frictions or any other challenges that you perhaps weren't expecting?
Can you repeat that?
What other challenges did you encounter when you were merging the two groups?
A host of different things. One of the big ones was trying to get folks that have been associated with a brand to say, it's okay if my customer goes to this brand. That was really hard because if I was historical Alamo Enterprise or National, I wanted all customers. And now we were saying to them on the field, and they get paid, remember the P&L, they get paid on the P&L. And so if you're over here, I want you over here. And that was hard for people to really grab hold of that. So we had to do a lot of teaching, training, and developing because that's not naturally intuitive for people. And the other was, one of the other things that was very, very difficult was a lot of the folks under the Alamo National, the rental agents that we had that were, you know, full-time permanent rental agents or return agents or car reps, there was a somewhat of a feeling, and not knowingly, but just a feeling that they were all going to be replaced by folks in white shirts and women in business dress and, you know, kind of the enterprise image, if you will. And they felt like they were going to be replaced. And so we had to calm those fears that, no, that wasn't the case. And so today, if you go to an airport, you'll see that there's three distinct delivery services, but the cars are all the same. It could be rented out under Alamo, under Enterprise, or National. The cars are agnostic. The service centers behind are agnostic. The management team is brand agnostic, and they're service-centric. It was hard to get everybody behind that. At a corporate office, our team did a great job, and in each of the departments, and then on the field, where they're actually doing that. So that was another big one that was very, very difficult.
Can you explain a little bit more about the management structure? Like, if after the acquisition of Alamo and Enterprise and National, how Enterprise manage the subsidiaries, and also, for example, if something happened in this subsidiary or something happened in the, some other country that Alamo have operation, how do you handle it? And like, how do you make communication flow efficiently between the subsidiaries? And do you talk about the opportunity for employees to learn and share the best employees between the subsidiaries? And so how can Enterprise make it happen so efficiently? Thank you.
I think I'll hit a number of those pieces in there. The management structure, this was a really great case study from management structure. Enterprise is a very decentralized management structure. We have management in each of the markets that we serve. We have a vice president, general manager, and they make the decisions. They have their own P&L. They do everything. The corporate office is a consulting arm. All wholly owned stores, but the decentralized nature, all the decisions from pricing to management to hiring to everything done out there underneath those core values and principles. And we've got great people that run all those. We have 70 different operating groups, and those 70 different individuals run those. And they report into the corporate office, but everything we do out there, they do. At Alamo National, it was a command and control business, okay, where there was a team of about 8 to 10 people located in Tulsa, Oklahoma, that made all the decisions. Okay? And then the dissemination of that went out in a communication, and all of the operations then implemented that, okay? On pricing and stuff, there was daily conversation, but for the management of the business, it was very command and control, and the other was very decentralized. So two different worlds, okay? I'll give you an example. Down in Miami, went down there, and under Alamo National, we were taking a walk on the lot and went over to visit with the service reps, the folks who wash the cars and make sure they're clean, and it was raining. And the roof to that, and this was right after we acquired it, the roof had holes in it and leaks, and so it was raining. They had the open cords and electrical and all these things. And so I was walking with the manager, and I was saying, you know, talking to the service reps, and said, help me understand, you know, what we got here and how come and all that. And they said, well, we're waiting for the finance committee to approve the repairs. And the finance committee was back in the home office. Not that it was good or bad, but it was the way it was run. Command and control versus decentralized. And so you watch the rain, you know, you got some danger for the employees. You go, well, that we can't have that. And so I said, well, we should get that fixed. Well, as soon as we get the finance committee to approve it, we put it in and do all that. And I said, well, we just approved it. Let's get it fixed. Because, you know, that was important. The folks on the ground need to make that decision, not some folks in, you know, 2-hour plane ride away. And so we empower the management. And so we had to go through a process of teaching people to empower them in the necessary market to do the repairs, take care of their employees, take care of their customers, do the right thing, buy the cars, do the different things. All the cars were purchased centrally. In the enterprise world, it's all purchased decentrally. They all make the decisions. And so it was really two different worlds from a management structure. So what we had to do is teach this one. And then what we did was we folded the Alamo National operations underneath that enterprise group structure and created enterprise holdings that supported three brands. So today, there is not a central Alamo National control. It is all decentralized into those operating structures, and it's called Enterprise Holdings. And we disseminate information through, in our training, every weekend in the St. Louis corporate office, we bring branch managers in, whether they're airports or our local branches. And virtually every weekend, we have anywhere from 40 to 60 people in that are going through training on a regular basis. And then we get together regionally, we get together nationally on a regular basis for training and hands-on and talking to everybody. So the dissemination. Outside the United States, in terms of the Alamo National, that franchise network reports to a franchise vice president we have that reports into me. And so our franchise network, we communicate, deal with, we go visit, we talk to differently than we manage this. All still part of it. We just had 50 of our franchise owners into St. Louis from all of Central and South America over the last week, earlier this week, for meetings for 2 days. And so we manage that separately. The same philosophy, but they're separate business owners, so we manage them differently than we manage the corporately owned stores. Does that help answer that?
While managing multiple brands, how did you decide to segment the market? And then how did you decide which segments to pursue?
That's a great question because we spent a lot of time on that. And one of the thoughts was, well, maybe you should go with two brands because three brands is too hard to manage. And two brands would be easier to manage. But as we segmented out the market, we figured there's different need states that everybody has for rental. And maybe it's an insurance replacement, maybe it's dealership replacement, maybe it's corporate travel, maybe it's inbound leisure, maybe it's online travel agency or opaque, maybe it's through an affinity channel like Costco, Sam's Club, whatever it may be. So there's all these different channels. And people shop and do behaviors different for each of those channels depending on what their need is. And so we segmented it, and then we looked at the size of the market and how we wanted to serve it. And our national brand we look at, and that's for the corporate business traveler. And it goes in, and we have a large sales force that goes out to the corporations for people that are on contracted corporate business. And they rent over and over and over again. And so we provide a specialized service for them in terms of bypass the counter. They know how to get from A to B as fast as possible, so they don't need to walk around a car. They're not concerned about getting out of the airport. They've been there 100 times. They want to get from A to B as fast as possible. We got their member profile, everything else. So that's that group, and we segment them. They don't want to show up at a location and have a tour plane that just got in, and there's 150 people from the tour operator that's showing up at the Alamo Airport, okay? They don't want to get behind that. They'll be very disappointed. The folks that are on a big tour, for example, with Alamo, they understand that part of the tour is I'm going in a group from place to place. So So at our Alamo brand, we service the tour, the travel, the inbound leisure, folks with a lot of kids and luggage going to Disney World, different things like that. And we're set up for that in terms of our level of service and how we do. We have kiosk, online check-in. We have all these things that they can do ahead of time. But they want to go out and look at the cars. They want to pick the one they want. They want to look around. They want somebody to help talk them and walk them through. And so we do that there. And then our enterprise brand is a combination. It's our high touch for folks that love love us in the home city. They come to the airport. They love the high touch service. They have a selection of vehicles that they can go and walk through, walk around the car. We talk to them in terms of where they're going, what they're doing. It's a very high level of service for a very fair, consistent, everyday price. And that's our enterprise brand at the airport. In the home city, we only have the enterprise brand. We don't have Alamo National in the home city. They're only at the airport in a select number of downtown locations. So that's how we've differentiated. And each of our segments have grown in double digits this past year, both on airport and off airport. We've grown in double digits this past year. So we think the segmentation has worked extremely well, and we haven't crossed over and share shifted internally. As you saw by the slides, we're share shifting from the rest of the industry to us. So we feel good about the brand segmentation. And that was probably one of the hardest things, is really disseminating that, because it's not intuitive. And so we do that. Also from pricing, we separate it and do all that. Excellent. Thank you very much.
That was a nice statistic to end on, wasn't it? Before everyone departs, I just want to give a few quick thank yous. There are a variety of people behind the scenes who help us put on these Dean's Distinguished Lecture Series, not the least of which is our good friends from industry who share their expertise with us. The entire staff in the Advancement Office, Dale Wright and Tim Hausman are here. The Academic Support Center, who record and project our voices so you can hear us. Recess photography over there. But of course, most importantly, Mr. Stubblefield, if you'll join me so that we can thank you properly. So, small token of our appreciation.
Oh, thank you.
This class. That thanks him for being our Dean's Distinguished Lecturer. So, thank you very much. Okay, thank you all very much for coming.